Yes, it's that time again. It is time for
that show.
That show that I can't remember the name of at this very moment in time because we've recently rebranded. Yes, Wordcraft. Thank you very much. I am your co-host, Kat Rocha, the night editor, and with me as always is...
I'm your pal, Jay Ashiro Finney, author and alien in a human suit. And if you're not reading my books, go over to Amazon right now and buy them because I said so.
Indeed.
So who's joining us?
We have an awesome guest this evening. We have Alex from Cursova. Did I have that right, Alex?
Curso with a hard C, but yeah.
Cursova. Sorry about that.
It's all right.
Well, okay. What does that mean?
It's an artifact name of back when our blog was still an OSR blog. It was the D&D setting that I was initially working on, but eventually I dropped it and just kept it for the name of the blog and then kept it for the name of the magazine because it had become our brand by then.
All right. Well, so for those of you listening who are unaware, Cursova is, I would say, probably one of the premier magazines right now publishing fiction that isn't woke, that is writing, pulp, superversive, and just heroic sci-fi and fantasy in the spirit of the good old days
when
the golden age when fiction was innovative and interesting and enjoyable and wasn't preaching at you.
And there's a link in the description below to their website, among other things, which we will be covering tonight.
So, despite my description. Oh, real quickly. We all know YouTube's terrible. Hit the like. Let everyone know we're live because people haven't been notified. So, Alex, how would you describe your magazine?
We are a magazine of adventure stories, romance, horror, mystery, a little bit of everything. We try to hit the high notes of the classic pulps. We are primarily known for our science fiction and fantasy, but we try to keep the door open to other classic genres of pulp fiction. Our main requirement is that they be exciting stories, gripping stories, maybe a little bit weird. Stories where things happen and people do cool stuff.
So, like, if I had a romance about vampire mud wrestlers in the 1850s, as long as it was exciting, it had a chance.
Yeah, you know, I mean, if it was a romance, like in the Alexandre Dumas sense of a romance.
Okay.
Nice. So, high adventure.
Yeah, high adventure. Like I said, we try to capture all of the exciting genres of the pulps, even though our primary focus that we're known for has been science fiction and fantasy. One of the reasons why we wanted to expand was because in 2019, a lost Edgar Rice Burroughs Tarzan story pretty much fell into our lap. You know, Tarzan's not really science fiction, he's not really fantasy, he's adventure. So that kind of gave us a good chance to rebrand the magazine from science fiction and fantasy to adventure and suspense. And that also helped us weed out more submissions of elf stories, which we typically reject.
Borrowing Studios said, no elves, no Cthulhu.
Those are two of our submission guidelines. No elves, no Cthulhu. We have occasionally been known to break the rule on elves if someone sends us something in the line of a Dunsanian story, like Charwoman Shadow type stuff, or King of Elfland's Daughter type stuff. We have not generally broken our rule on Cthulhu, though.
Well, I would have to say, having a hard rule of no elves, no Cthulhu in your submission guidelines is a huge improvement, because over the last 5-6 years, as a working writer who's done both comics and novels, one of the biggest problems I've had with the fiction publication or magazines is usually they say no white guys.
Yeah. your guideline is no, a no on specific content, not a no on the submitter.
Yes, we are known for publishing a diverse range of fiction. we do not really care about the race, ethnicity, whatnot of the heroes and characters, as long as you send us a good story.
Which is what it is all about. I mean,
definitely a company I can get behind.
I think that's kind of what everybody's been kind of craving again is, hey, tell us a good story.
Yeah, I just want a good story. I don't care. You know, I'll look up the author if I really enjoy it and find out what else they do. But all I want is a good story.
And as far as the Tarzan's concerned, in my opinion, even though that's high adventure, it set the standard for so many things to come after it, including what John Carter and you name it. You go down.
John Carter was actually first, I think.
Really?
Yeah, by a couple of years. Tarzan was really his big breakout hit, though.
But yeah, there was like so many things that Tarzan influenced that was either a fantasy or sci-fi.
He kind of codified the strongman trope that you could make it really work in a modern setting as well as an ancient setting. So, you know, if you wanted to take a Hercules type strongman character and set him at the time modern turn of the century, you would end up with a character kind of like Tarzan.
So how does a Tarzan story fall into your possession? This sounds like an Indiana Jones thing.
Yeah. So, Michael Tierney, who is one of our regular contributors, we have been publishing his Wild Stars book for several years now. He owned two of the comic book shops in town. He is a pulp historian with a particular focus on art and art as it pertains to the pulp, specifically Edgar Rice Burroughs. And so he had a lot of connections at the time with the old estate. He was friends with Danton Burroughs, who I believe was Edgar Rice Burroughs' son or grandson. I can't remember off the top of my head right now. But Danton Burroughs came to him with this fragment that was about halfway finished, but it just didn't have an ending. And he said, I've been trying to figure out something to do with this, and I was wondering if you would be interested in trying to give a shot at finishing this. And he said, okay, sure. And he worked on it. He came up with a really cool, exciting story and worked out an ending that fit in with the Jungle Tales era Young Tarzan canon. But before anything could be done with it, there was the fire at the Burroughs estate that destroyed a whole bunch of records, original art, and manuscripts. Oh. And Danton Burroughs passed away shortly thereafter. And so for years, Michael just sort of had been sitting on this story that he'd finished. He didn't have any contacts really with the new people who were handling the Burroughs estate until he had started working on his 4-volume Edgar Rice Burroughs 100-year art chronology. And so he'd finally started making contacts with the people at the estate again. And he was like, well, I've got this story and I've got this magazine that's interested in publishing it. What would you guys want to do with it? So, you know, we ended up working out all these deals with the estate, had all this paperwork ready and signed, ready to go. And we ended up getting it for a song because it was not until the drop dead day that we had all the contracts signed. Michael has them on the phone and it finally dawns on them, oh, this isn't a story that Michael just wrote. This was actually an Edgar Rice Burroughs story that Michael finished.
Which is awesome.
And the thing was all the contracts and stuff were already agreed to. And so all the payment was set up. So we probably got this for way, way less than it would have cost us if they had been aware the entire time that this was actually an Edgar Rice Burroughs story.
Okay. Which issue of Kurosawa could we find this in?
Mm-hmm. It is in the spring 2019 issue. It was our new number one when we switched over from Magazine of Heroic Fantasy and Science Fiction to Magazine of Thrilling Adventure and Daring Suspense.
Very cool. And the link to all the issues on Amazon are in the description. So if you guys want to go nab that, very affordable, especially on Kindle. But yeah, I prefer hard copy.
So after we made the announcement that we were publishing this lost Tarzan story, the word started to get around some of the Burroughs circles, and the person who actually had the original manuscript was like, "Oh, hey, I've got the original manuscript." And so shortly thereafter, this thing was found. They'd previously not had any records of it because the records of it existing had been destroyed in the fire. But then because Michael came to us with this story, they actually, the guy who had his hands on the manuscript was able to come out of the woodworks and say, "Hey, here's this thing. It's authentic."
That's excellent. So shifting topics a bit, there was something else you guys did a while back that I thought was just excellent, which is a beautiful version of Black Amazon of Mars.
Oh, yeah. I think it was 2019. We did an illustrated Stark. We took the three novellas from Planet Stories by Lee Brackett and did them up in fully illustrated editions. We were working with Star 2, an art team out of Portugal, and they came up with new covers that were based on the original Alan Anderson covers, but we changed the character designs to make them look more consistent with how they were described in the stories.
Well, that's what really struck me.
Then we had an illustration for each chapter.
Well, that was one thing that really struck me about the cover art, was that it was definitely a shout out to the old pulp art cover, but it looked consistent with how she's actually described in the story.
Yeah, and you know, one of the really hard decisions we had to make with Black Amazon of Mars is, even though that's probably the most iconic Planet Stories cover, it's terrible because it ruins the twist of one of the best science fiction stories ever written. Because the twist in Black Amazon of Mars is that Darth Vader is a sexy redhead under the armor. But if you have her on the cover with her hair out wearing boob armor, that's a pretty big spoiler.
Although one thing that's kind of interesting is I did some research into that story. And what was curious was that predates Eowyn, removing the helmet in Lord of the Rings or Return of the King.
Mm-hmm.
Black Amazon did it first.
Well, it wasn't so much a removing moment as it got knocked off in a fight. So.
But still, you know, what an epic reveal.
But it even has the whole "join me and rule all of Mars by my side" moment from Empire. where at the time, I mean, Stark doesn't know that it's a woman in the armor because the voice is all distorted by the helmet that she's wearing.
And then we see that trope repeated again in Empire Strikes Back.
Mm-hmm.
Which she wrote the original draft for.
Yes, she did.
Oh, she wrote the original draft we saw it again in Jedi with Princess Leia in Jabba's Palace. Oh,
the helmet reveal?
Yeah.
Oh.
So, yeah, very, very cool. So, I guess, aside from that, you've got something going with Mongoose and Meerkat on Kickstarter?
Yeah, right now we are in the process of collecting and releasing a volume of the 6th through 12th Mongoose and Meerkat stories, or 6th through 11th Mongoose and Meerkat stories by Jim Brayfogle. It is a series of picaresque fantasy adventures, sort of in the vein of Fafhrd and the Grey Mouser, but it's a guy and girl duo, and the focus is on the point of view character is the guy, and the girl is kind of the mystery box of the series. But if you enjoy classic sword and sorcery adventures of rogues going on odd job type quests, trying to make money, trying to trick bad guys out of a little bit of loot, then this is definitely a series for you. We've been running them since I think we started in late 2017, our fall 2017 issue. And we ran a couple after that, and then Jim Brayfogle told us, well, I've got the entire series written. And I'm like, well, okay. And so we put an offer on the entire series. And after we bought all of the stories, we've been just running them one story an issue, every issue since last year.
Okay, well, since you've got 8 days to go and you're at almost $4,000, I really think that this should be at least $4,000, guys.
Yeah. Well, the first one made a little over $5,000.
Well, hopefully more people will jump on at the last minute because, yeah, this looks amazing. And
yes,
I love
it does.
That cover art.
Yeah, thank you. People also had more money a couple of years ago with how inflation is.
Yeah. I'm glad you got it then, right?
Yeah.
But excellent.
So in this collection, the stories, they're at the point in their adventuring career. This is the second year that they've been adventuring together. So they've got a little bit more experience under their belt. They're a little bit better at their jobs. They're a little less likely to screw things up or have their employer get killed, which happened in a couple of the other earlier adventures. They're setting up shop in Alamar, which is a city where anything and anyone can be bought and sold, provided you can meet the price. And they're stacking up their coins. Mongoose is mostly using his money to fill his belly and keep his wineskins full. Meerkat, she's being a little bit more judicious. She has big plans for what she's doing with her portion of the score, but we're going to find out more of that in Volume 3.
Nice.
Yeah, that's very cool.
So, you know, definitely looks high adventure. I know with these sorts of stories, they tend to lean either towards the serious-minded or the more comedic, though they may have, you know, tinges of both. Where would you put these stories? What category?
It kind of depends on where you are in the series arc. If you've been following along in the magazine, the stories are about to take a really serious turn in the fall issue. But up until the issue that just came out, most of them are pretty light. It's lighthearted. It's not really like twee, silly, goofy Robert Aston or Terry Goodkind type stuff, but it's still fun, a little bit lighthearted, but it's going to be taking a serious turn as it enters its final arc.
Excellent.
All right, so we got a question here for you.
Mm-hmm. Dominic asks, has anyone the conversation of subversive fiction started yet? Have we started talking about subversive fiction? What's the current
superversive?
Oh, superversive. I apologize.
Superversive is isn't subversive. It's about raising up rather than undermining,
which I'm all for. And what is the current status of, Curse of a Magazine?
I'm not really sure how to answer that. Do you mean, are we ongoing? Are we taking submissions? We are currently putting out the magazine on a quarterly basis. We usually buy a year's worth of submissions in one go. Our next submission window is going to be August 1st through the 7th. And we're planning on maintaining a quarterly release if we can help it.
Okay, so for everyone listening, because I know a lot of you guys are writers or aspiring writers, You can go to the description, and down there, I actually linked the submission guidelines, so you guys can get ahead of that.
And Dominic clarified, he was asking if you are ongoing.
Yeah, I mean, we just put out an issue about a week ago, and our next issue is slated for a release in September, and then there's one slated after that for December, and we are actually taking advertisements for those issues right now, which that money is going to be the quickest cash injection we'll get to have money to buy content for next year.
Good to know.
That's very good to know.
And our series, we do a lot of standalone stories. Most of our fiction tends to be standalone. We are running Mongoose and Meerkat as an ongoing serial. There are 18 installments. I think we just ran the 12th or the 13th. I can't remember which. We have also started serializing a few novels from a couple of our regulars, including Michael Tierney's Wild Stars, which he has been working on since the 70s. He's got to the point where now that his comic shops are closed, he's devoting all of his time to writing. And when he is not working on his Robert E. Howard art history 4-volume set, he is working on the 7th installment of Wild Stars, which he is hoping to get to us in time to serialize next year. We're also serializing a novel from Dave Ritzlin, who runs DMR Books. He's become sort of a living legend almost in the sword and sorcery field right now, and really they're one of the publishers that I look up to right now. He's doing a lot of good work, so it's really cool that we're actually serializing one of his novels, and the first installment of that is in the issue that just came out last week.
Very cool.
Excellent. Wow.
That's pretty impressive.
Yeah, we do also have a few other recurring characters, you know, sort of like how Conan would show up and have different standalone adventures. We have a few writers who've been turning in several standalone adventures of the same characters, but it's not necessarily like an ongoing story or series the way that Mongoose and Meerkat or Wild Stars or the other things that we've been serializing are.
All right, so to throw a curveball at you, I remember a while back, first off, it's very clear that you know your pulps well, and you're definitely all about keeping that tradition alive as well as keeping the older fiction alive. But I do recall, and I think it was an editorial you posted, about quality dropping with Pulp Rev. And if you don't want to talk about that, that's cool. But I was just curious, what's your take on that?
I'm not really sure of the context because, you know, I need a little bit more context than that because, Pulp Rev is pretty, there are a lot of people involved in it, and, there are books that I have read from some authors in the Pulp Rev that, you know, I have enjoyed, but I'm like, this definitely needs an editor to go through it. And, you know, the first couple issues of Kursova magazine are really rough because even though I can do some copy editing, you know, when you're one person going through all that fiction, you're bound to miss a lot of stuff. Oh, I see somebody's asking about Wild Stars in the chat. Michael Tierney actually has a website. It's thewildstars.com, and he's got a complete history of all the Wild Star stuff he's been working on and doing since the 70s.
Okay, there we go. Not bad. Now, I just recall that there was I should have done my homework a little better. It's been a while since I read it. But you were talking about how you really liked the spirit and the idea of bringing pulp back, but that there did seem to be kind of a trade-off between the amount of time being spent on writing these versus, essentially polishing quality.
I honestly can't really recall the specifics of any of that conversation, so I can't really speak to it that much.
Oh, that's okay. I don't mean to put you on the spot here. I was just kind of curious what you're.
Yeah, I mean,
if you had any further take on that, or
the one thing I will say is that for a while, there was a tendency to make the Pulp Rev be almost like a brand, and people were kind of running to it for clout when it was kind of blowing up. So I mean, you would see authors who were not in the circles of the people who are still involved with the Pulp Rev or Pulp Revolution now. They would be saying that they were Pulp Rev authors. They were tweeting out Pulp Rev, and they put it in their bio, but like we didn't know who these people were. And at the same time, originally the Pulp Revolution was a description of what people were doing, what I was doing, what Jeffro was doing with his Appendix N stuff. I want to say it was Daddy Warpig who was one of the first ones who said that what we were doing, what Jeffro was doing, and what a few other people out there were doing was a pulp revolution.
Well, he's been a massive supporter of getting the word out.
Yeah.
Daddy Warpig is the reason why I found Pulp Rev.
Yeah. But at the same time, we did not want it to turn into like an identity-based movement. We didn't want it to be like a Gamergate type thing or a Comics Gate type thing where people, you know, identify as this or seek clout. And as one of the bigger names at the time in the scene, we didn't want people to be like, oh, well, if you've been published in Cursova, that makes you Pulp Rev. We aren't selling cred to people when we buy stories. We're not drafting people into the Pulp Rev, and we're not excluding people from the Pulp Rev. If they wanted to be involved with it, that's fine. But we did not necessarily want to be like the Pulp Rev Pope, like issuing decrees and saying who's this and who's that.
Well,
and because of the political nature of some of the individuals involved, especially myself, we did not necessarily want people to be forcibly drafted into something that they did not know about, especially if it was going to turn into something like a Gamergate or a Comics Gate.
Yeah.
Well, I want to get Fiona's take on that in a minute, but no, you did answer my question. That is exactly what you were posting about. And no, I agree, honestly. I really like the idea of Pulp Rev being an idea, an attitude, and a community, kind of like the way cyberpunk was in the early 80s. It was an attitude and an idea. It wasn't some sort of coherent group of cool kids in the corner. And when it did become that, it kind of went downhill.
Yeah, whereas a lot of the pulp stuff was kind of emerging almost as a standalone complex. Bryce Beatty came out with his Story Hack stuff. I didn't know who Bryce was, but he was coming out with a magazine that, I mean, in a lot of ways is like Cursova's twin. I haven't had a chance to read as much of those as I would like, but in the first issue, the best thing I can say is if any of those stories had been submitted to me, I would have bought them.
All right, Fiona, you've been dying to talk to this man. Let's hear what you have to say.
I got another audiobook. I don't even care that I already own Meerkat audiobook. I'm going to gift my other copy of audiobook to somebody.
Hey, that's cool. I really appreciate that. How are you doing, Fiona? This is the first time we have talked besides just tweets and Discord.
And war on PIB.
Yeah.
What?
Pronoun and bio people. Every time I say something really controversial, I get all these people with pronouns in their bios saying how they're never going to submit any stories to me. And I'm like, good, don't waste my time. I'm already front loaded 75,000 words of fiction for next year. I don't need you wasting my time.
Okay, yeah. I'm just going to be an asshole and say that when we were taking submissions for stories, if somebody had pronouns in their bio, we didn't even look at the story.
Yeah.
It's like, why bother?
Nah. And they that one guy he tried to respond on my thread, the one that was ass mad about you.
Oh, was that that Doggin guy?
Yes.
Yeah, that guy was ass mad for over a week.
and I'm still keeping up.
He wasn't even the guy who I called the F word.
Oh, yes. Florida, you know, Alpha. Yes. But man, they started review bombing. And I'm like, no, I'm going to review bomb back, but tell people what's actually in said cereals. Yes. Because really, guys, it doesn't even matter if you put it like book am good.
Yeah, I mean, it only takes a few seconds to leave a review on Amazon, and that's really the easiest, fastest, cheapest way that you can support any independent author or creator on Amazon is just by leaving a quick review. I mean, if some butthurt dude on the internet can like leave half a dozen reviews just because he's mad, I mean, people who actually like it should be able to too.
Well, yes. Yeah, that would be my thing that I constantly repeat is if you actually want good fiction, if you want these indie books to be noticed, the best thing you can do is leave an Amazon review or a Goodreads review. Don't even, you know, the reviews in magazines really aren't all that important anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, really, it's word of mouth like this and what's, you know, in the review columns on Amazon and Goodreads. But I must admit, there are books I've purchased by seeing the one-star reviews and saying, this pissed off all the right people. I need right? this.
It's like, wait, I'm allergic to fun. Oh, no.
So I saw Mark Mosray ask what our favorite pulp story or stories mm-hmm. are and how Kurosawa is inspired by the pulps. It's really hard to point to an absolute favorite, but one of the primary inspirations for Kurosawa magazine is the old Planet Stories pulp. We even went so far as to try to make our typeface resemble the typeface used in the original Planet Stories for the interiors. But I think if I had to go for one of my all-time favorite pulp stories, Raiders of the Second Moon by Basil Wells. It's just this 10-page short story about an astronaut who's going to a moon that's hidden behind our moon. It's a jungle world. He's chasing a Nazi mad scientist. He crashes in the jungle. He loses his memory. He becomes friends with ape people. He's got a hot, not ape lady girlfriend from like the local jungle people tribe. She gets kidnapped by these cultists wearing invisibility cloaks. It turns out that the cultists wearing invisibility cloaks are people who've been given super Nazi tech by the Nazi mad scientist. He goes to the skull temple, wrecks their shit, saves the hot girl, kicks the crap out of the Nazi scientist, and you know, he ends up with the girl. It's all crammed into 10 pages, and it's got to be one of the best in terms of hitting all of the notes of what is an awesome pulp science fiction story, just in such a dense amount of space. And so if I had to point to one, I think that's probably my favorite.
That should be a movie.
Yeah.
I'd see that film.
Yeah. On Castalia House, when I reviewed it years and years ago, I actually came up with stats for how to run it as a short Dungeons and Dragons adventure.
Oh, nice.
So that's what I do appreciate about BroSR. They're like, we're put Barsoom into our campaign. Yay!
Well, you know, one of the interesting things about the whole pulp revolution is, in a way, it kind of grew out of the OSR, particularly Jeffro and myself and a few other people. And a lot of the people who came from the OSR and into the pulp rev, eventually, a lot of us are people who became the BroSR. So, I mean, like, you still got, like, me, Rick Stump, Jeffro, B-Dubs.
Not John Dacre.
Yeah, we've actually got a cover story in our winter issue from him. We've run one of his stories before, but he's getting his first cover this winter.
I'm going to still buy that? Yep.
No, I take it back. This may be his first story with us. I think I've seen one or two of his before, but this may be the first one that we've bought. Hey, John, you're in the chat. This is your first sale to us, right?
Well, he's not going to be able to answer immediately, so.
Oh, alas. Well, he can answer in his own good time, but he sold us a really good story, and like I said, we made it a cover story, and it has an interior illustration.
Nice.
Well, you know, actually, let me ask you this then, because we do have some excellent artists who follow this show. And what are your submissions and rates for illustrators?
See, here's the thing. We have so many artists who have wanted to work with us and so little budget for lots of art. It's kind of a case of, if you hit us up with a portfolio that we really like, we will try to keep you in mind. And eventually, if we have something come across our desk that we think would be a good fit, we would circle back and hit them up for it. Like the artist who did our winter cover was a case where a studio from, I think, Singapore contacted us to say, would you be interested in anything that we're doing? And I'm like, I love your stuff, but I don't have anything for you right now. And then we got that story from Caroline Furlong that was Wolf Mechs on the Moon. And I'm like, all right, I got something for you. And so we circled back to them and had them do the illustrations and cover for that. Now, our main regular cover illustrator is Anton Oxenuk. He's been doing stuff with us since 2018. But we have a handful of others that we have been using. Our most recent cover for our summer issue is by Apriati Kuzbiantoro. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. We've got one from Tessa Rose and the Winter. We've also had covers from Benjamin Rodriguez. We've even had one from Kukurio. Our interior artist for a lot of our stuff recently has been Dark Philly.
Okay. Well, just again, out of curiosity, just what are spot illustration rates?
We pay about $500 to $600 for our covers. Okay. Our interiors, we're paying $200 for physical media. Jesse White is also doing illustrations for us this year, and so we're working with him on the Wild Star stuff. He's another one of the guys who's big in the pulp sphere at the moment. Yeah. So
JC, send them a portfolio.
Yeah, so here's one of the things that I tell people. We pay pro rates for art because pro quality art is always in demand. We pay semi-pro rates for fiction because there's just an insurmountable amount of quality fiction out there, and there are so many places that will pay peanuts or nothing at all and still manage to get good fiction. And there are authors out there who will say, please just publish my story, you don't even have to pay me. That there is so much downward pressure on the price, the market price of fiction. But
I'm going to interrupt you here.
Okay.
Oh, sorry.
I was going to say, but with artists, we know that art is such an important aspect of catching eyes and grabbing readers' attention that we go for pro rates on our art.
Now, I'm going to just step up and use this moment as a soapbox because it needs to be said. Writers out there, even you new guys, never do it for free.
Never.
This is see what this situation that Alex is describing is why you never do it for free.
Mm-hmm.
Because it does drive the price down to the point where, and let me tell you, this happens in comics too, where they think, well, you want it published so badly, we just will give you pennies or we'll actually make you pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, always, yeah. Always, even if it's just pennies, don't do it for free.
Yeah, and one of the things I always recommend is if you're trying to start a publication or trying to do an anthology, do a per word rate, even if it's something tiny, even if it's like half cent per word, mm-hmm. that's better than token, and even token is better than copies. Like one of our friends was wanting to do an anthology thing. He was like, well, I'm thinking about maybe sending each contributor 5 copies. And I'm like, yo, for the cost of sending them 5 copies, you could pay them at least like $25, and that'd probably be better than 5 copies of the book.
Yeah.
But like I said, there's so much downward pressure on the market value of fiction, especially short fiction, that, you know, even paying what we pay, which I feel like isn't very much, is trying to keep a little bit of upward pressure on it. But it also means that we can't buy as much as we would like. Like every year we get at least 2 or 3 issues worth of stories that if I had the money and time to buy and publish them, I would, but I just can't. So
to be brutal, honestly, when I was telling you that I was having such a hard time getting fiction publications to run my stories because of weird woke politics, I actually did the math and came to the realization, you know, just selling them for 99 cents on my Amazon account would make me more money anyways, and it has.
Yeah, probably.
No, it has.
I'm just saying that for most writers, that's probably the case. If you can't make a sale, to an outlet that is paying at least semi-pro rates, you're probably better off self-publishing it. If you can build any sort of following on your blog, on social media, just get your stuff out there. Mm-hmm. Now, one of the advantages that we offer as sort of a value add is that after 6 months, we send the authors back their stories with all of the corrections that we've done, because we put everything through 3 rounds of edits. I do edits, Javier does edits, Mark does edits. And then once all those edits are in, we give everybody a last chance to get any final corrections in. And so that version of the story that we publish is the one that we send back to the authors so that they can use that version when they put out an anthology or sell it themselves. And so, I mean, that's a value add right there, that they don't have to pay for their own copy editing for their fiction.
Which is actually kind of a value, trust mm-hmm. me.
Yeah. It's a major value.
Yeah, and apparently that's not something a lot of other publications do. They don't send out the published text in a doc format to everybody.
I thought you were going to say something else, which is true, which is copy editing, something that a lot of publications don't do anymore.
Yeah, that's something else yeah. too that I've heard of. But, can't really speak to that. I mean, we do our best, but
no, I'm thinking like Time Magazine.
Or even some in the big trad pub spheres. Like, you look at some of these samples, I'm like, wow, yet they give indies crap? Like, what?
Oh, that one semi-pro zine that won a Hugo, I think, last year, FIA, the black speculative fiction magazine. I decided when that came out, I'd be the one who took the hit and tried to read it. And I couldn't make it through like the second story. One of them was, like one of the first stories in the first issue was a second person that was all Lord Child. And like, I can't do this.
Oh my God.
Oh, it kind of reminds me how I had to go looking for, what was it? The one where the person was a helicopter or that won some sort of accolades from certain pink sci-fi outlets.
The one that tried to do the I identify as an attack helicopter.
Yeah.
Made it straight.
Yeah.
Dogpiled because you're not allowed to play that straight even for laughs. Because. Yeah, no.
All right. So there is one other thing I want to bring up since we're coming 15. We're at what, 15 minutes left for the show. Mm-hmm. Misha Burnett's horror anthology.
Yes. As soon as we get the Mongoose and Meerkat collection out the door, we are taking pre-orders for Misha Burnett's An Atlas of Bad Roads. It is a very, very strange horror anthology. I mean, this is stuff that's too weird for Kursova magazine. But if any of you guys are familiar with Misha Burnett, he is absolute master of the macabre. He is one of the few people out there writing some really, really interesting takes on horror and fantasy that take the mundane world and really, really get at the uncanny aspects of it. A lot of times you get the sort of mundane fiction or urban horror that just really can't quite get its finger on how to make weird work and how to make uncanny horror work. But Misha just, it's like an early Nick Cave album in the form of horror short fiction. You know, that's the best way to compare it. You know, it's like The Firstborn is Dead, but as an anthology of short fiction.
That's one hell of an endorsement.
Yeah.
He has very particular tastes, which, you know, I think that's more vital to actually have more wheelhouses out there for these writers that want to see specific things. It's like, here, platform them. This is why I want to strangle Con Inc. Yeah.
Okay,
I swear, if I get
yep.
somewhat big, I'm going to keep platforming people.
Damn straight. You know, we need to get you in contact with Ralts.
Yeah.
I think you'd like Ralts.
Who?
The author we routinely bring on the show who...
Mm-hmm. Roland Yonzi?
Ralts Bloodthorn.
Mm-hmm. Oh, different Ralt. Okay.
And you want to talk about someone who's writing, you know, straight pulp, superversive fiction that's mm-hmm. you know, wild and out there and brilliant. He's the man.
Mm-hmm.
And he's a man that is inspired by being struck by lightning.
Yes.
That's a hell of an inspiration.
All right. So we're coming up to the end of the hour here. Mm-hmm. So I guess at this point, what?
Well, is there anything that we either did not cover or you would like to cover further before the end of the show?
Were there any questions in the chat that we missed?
I'm here to just do link through.
Here's one. Yes. How do you feel best to make true pulps while being inviting for today's readers? Really, the trick is exciting stories where things happen. Too much fiction these days are boring stories about degenerate people where nothing of any consequence or interest happens. And, you know, the antidote for that is have stories about awesome, exciting people doing awesome, exciting things, having adventures where actions have consequence.
Please, please give your protagonist some sort of virtue. So many postmodern people give them nothing but flaws and misery.
Or, you know, you don't have a good balance of the two. And yeah, I'm sick of all these, you know, stunning and brave women or stunning and brave people of color or the alphabet soup crowd. And then, you know, you may have a character that actually does have flaws, but they tend to be really lame.
Or how about telling a story about someone who seems to just be an average person who is unspectacular in every way, and then suddenly, in one shining moment, finds the strength to do something good and right and rise above.
No, you can't have that. They must be like cunning and brave.
That's why I appreciate CJ Carella, because he takes the everyman kind of person, whether it's a man or a woman, and puts him in strange situations, even with his lit RPG stuff. And I'm not even usually big on lit RPG, but he does it very well. But then again, he's also a tabletop designer, so it makes sense.
Yeah. But I mean, I wish that I wish that we had a little bit more time, because I'm remembering now how next year, I'm hoping next year that we will be able to start putting together an anthology series inspired by the Sons of Hercules series. I don't know if you guys are familiar with that, but it was...
No, I'm not.
It was an old syndicated program where they took Italian peplum movies like Hercules, Machiste, stuff like that, and they redubbed them and gave them their own little intro and outro to try to make them a thematic series of their own that they could sell to syndication broadcast. And so I've been going back and rewatching a lot of those movies because I used to watch them as a kid. And
oh,
so
fun.
Yeah, oh, they're tons of fun. And so one of the ideas I have is to do a Sons of Hercules anthology. Various strong men going around righting injustices, saving captive women, defeating evil viziers and wicked queens. And I've actually got a cornerstone story for the first anthology written that once I get it edited, I'm going to start doing solicits for it. But that's something to talk about later. That's going to be coming up in a couple years, maybe.
Well, before we get to the next question, Alex, when you said it's a shame we don't have much more time, you're welcome to come back anytime. You want to promote something, you've got a topic, just
let us know.
Email me or contact me on Twitter. We'll schedule your time to come on.
Awesome.
Yes. Excellent.
Mark asks, speaking of strong women, Kursova, what did Pulps teach you about writing female characters?
Well, see, here's the thing. A lot of people think that women were written weak in the Pulps. Were really women... No. Kind of suffer from the Worf effect in the Pulps, where you have these really awesome, tough, kick-ass dames who, the way that you see that things have gotten really bad is when the tough, kick-ass dame who kind of shit-tests the hero finally has to ask the guy with a ray gun for help. That's how bad things have gotten. So you end up with all these really cool femme fatale type characters or smart scientists or even like the ray gun slinging gals themselves or even swordswomen. But the trick is you have to have a guy who is cool enough to be worthy of them. Like so many stories these days, and honestly, this is something that anime has not helped with. You have the girl and the loser protagonist, where you need, if you've got a really awesome girl, you have to have a guy who's awesome enough to be worthy of her.
It's almost like half the guys that are in some of these stories, they're like the wallflower version of a guy. Like, and then you're wondering, why did this lady fall for such a guy, you know?
That's real hardcore fantasy.
I mean, there's a movie that we absolutely love called Weather Woman, where, you know, she, you know, has like the biggest dick in the room.
figuratively speaking.
She has this, wormy little pipsqueak who like literally licks her boots. And she never falls for him. She just uses him for all of the things.
And it's terrible to watch stuff like that. It may have worked and been funny when stuff like that was first introduced, but it's one of those tropes that ages like milk. There's this one manga series that I read recently that was serialized in the 90s by Dark Horse, Caravan Kid. And I mean, it has a really good idea behind it, but watching the interactions between like the cool kick-ass girl and like the weaselly loser guy is just, I don't want to see this. It's dumb, tired of it. Because you just see it in so many places. You don't have the strong male lead who's worthy of a strong female lead.
Rereading Barsoom, I'm like, yes, this is where you can see that they're a team. They fit each other's weaker points and they become stronger as a team.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, you want to know what kind of male protagonists that are going to get the girl that women like? Read Lay Brackett stuff.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Even read Lensman. I love Lensman. Man, Green Lantern took so much from Lensman.
It took his putting it kindly.
All right. Well, it's time to give the links.
Yes. So where can people find Kursova, or what should people look for that Kursova has put out so far?
All right. Well, the easiest way to find Kursova is if you're looking to buy stuff on Amazon, just type in Kursova. It'll all pop up. All of our stuff is available there. If you want to dig a little bit deeper, you can check out our website at kursova.wordpress.com. We have links to our various major authors in our top menu, as well as some of our other projects. That's an easy way to find everything that we have out and what we're working on. Right now, we have a Kickstarter live for the second volume of Mongoose and Meerkat. That's down there in the description. We will be launching that Misha Burnett anthology as soon as the Mongoose and Meerkat one is done. If you wanted to check out Michael Tierney's Wild Stars, thewildstars.com. And I think that's it as far as the links. That's all I can think of off the top of my head.
And all of those links are in the description, including one that goes directly to Amazon.
Mm-hmm. And to the Kickstarter.
Yeah. And yeah, support that Kickstarter. We got to keep good fiction going.
Yes.
Please.
I'm going to jump in, and you know, usually I promote some of my work, but right now I'm going to talk about Free. And that's right. Right now, preview chapters of my upcoming Boobs of Steel, Busty Heroines and the Culture War nonfiction is being posted to the Discord. That is linked in the description. Mm-hmm. So if you want to start reading some of the chapters of what's going to be a 12-chapter book and coming out very soon, here you go. Now's the chance.
Mm-hmm. And Fiona, where can people find you?
Birdside of Hell at Fiona Wolf 2. And then just you can search for Upload Protocol. It should be one of the first results that pops up nowadays. Yes.
Excellent. All right. Thank you so much, Alex, for joining us this evening.
Oh, thank you for having me.
Of course, our pleasure. And definitely, please let us know, you know, the next issue that comes out, their next project that you are promoting. Please let us know. We'd love to have you back on.
Yeah, like I said, anything you want to promote anytime, just, you know, send me a tweet or an email. Mm-hmm. Or if you have any friends you think should talk to us and come on the air. This show exists to hook readers up with good fiction.
Yes.
Well, thank you again for having me.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Fiona, why don't you lead us out here?
I wish I was a billionaire so I could put all of Pulp Rev on my back and be like, let's go, people. Yes.
That works for me.
I love that. I get behind that.
All right. Good night, everyone.
Good night, everyone.
Night.